Je voudrais maintenant inviter la deuxième modératrice, Madame Valérie Sasportas, à nous rejoindre et à introduire la table ronde et inviter les panélistes.
Mesdames, Messieurs, je vous propose de commencer tout de suite la deuxième table ronde de cet après-midi. Table ronde qui concerne le débat éthique. Cette table ronde va explorer les enjeux posés par le débat éthique, en effet, que génère la circulation des biens culturels. Nous allons avoir autour de cette table des universitaires et des représentants d'organisations internationales. Tous ont une longue expérience de recherche et de gestion de projets sur le sens et la signification des objets pour les communautés d'origine. J'espère que vous m'entendez. Moi, je vous entends bien. L'objectif est d'inventer des modèles flexibles qui répondent aux réalités socio-économiques et culturelles des pays concernés, et d'envisager les modalités économiques du partage de patrimoine. Les frais multiples liés à la circulation des objets et les valeurs acquises sur le marché de l'art, dont on vient de parler, intègrent une dimension économique à la réflexion sur la mobilité des biens culturels. Je vais tout de suite appeler nos invités sur ce panel. Monsieur Georges Abungu, s'il vous plaît, vous êtes invité. Directeur général émérite des musées nationaux du Kenya. Bonjour. Également, Monsieur Wen Wendland, qui est directeur de la division des savoirs traditionnels à l'OMPI. Madame Nazima Kamardine, de l'Université de Colombo au Sri Lanka. Nice to meet you again. Madame France Desmarais, directrice des programmes et des partenariats à l'ICOM. Et enfin, Monsieur Jean-Gabriel Le Turc, qui est expert conseil en coopération muséale internationale. Sans attendre, nous allons commencer. Le temps est assez court et je vous demanderai d'être concis afin que vous puissiez chacun exprimer la totalité de ce que vous avez à dire, ou du moins le maximum, c'est pas évident. Monsieur Georges Abungu, je vais commencer par vous. Vous êtes professeur d'université et ces questions de restitution, ça fait plus de 20 ans que vous vous y attachez. Je vais tout de suite vous poser la première question, évidemment. La question de la circulation des biens s'inscrit dans le temps long. Le débat est relancé aujourd'hui sous un nouveau jour. Comment percevez-vous l'évolution des réflexions sur la mobilité des biens culturels ces 20 dernières années que vous avez auscultées ?
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Well, that introduction makes me feel quite old. 20 years working on this, and it's true, I guess. Well, first of all, as the tradition, I assume that you are awake. I mean, I've seen many people sleeping, but you can sleep if you want to. But I assume you're awake. I'm talking to people who are awake. Let me first of all start by thanking UNESCO for the invitation and also for crafting such a fantastic discussion about a subject that is so close to our heart. I personally have been involved in this at different levels, within the bureaucracy as Director General, as a professor teaching, as an archaeologist practicing, as a consultant, or sitting in World Heritage Committee, or being Vice President of ICOM. So in different areas, and I guess at different times, maybe I had my different interest. But now on reflection, I think I have very good idea of how I would like this to be. I think to begin with, maybe if I was given the opportunity to redraft the title of this discussion, I would have probably left some words. Maybe instead of cultural property, I could have said cultural inheritance or cultural heritage. And then instead of probably, what is the other one? Shared heritage, I would ask myself, if a heritage was taken under duress, if a heritage was stolen, or if a heritage was taken under circumstances that the loser did not have the power to defend itself, would we still call it shared? So maybe I'll ask Lazar and the team that maybe the next title of the conference, and this one serves as a good beginning, but the next one, probably instead of shared, maybe we could have appropriated heritage so that it reflects. But this is politically very correct. That is where I'm starting from. I think UNESCO has done a fantastic job, but I think there are other bodies, and they have been mentioned, like ICOM and others who have been working in this area. And for the last 20 years, and 20 years is a very short time, we've seen a great evolution. We do know that heritage that we find, particularly in the north, has been appropriated through different means. A lot of it through force, during colonial times, subsequently through thefts, even archaeological diggings, and also during difficult times in places of conflicts like wars and other places that we have, particularly in Africa, that this continues up to now. And of course, there are markets where they find themselves, and some of them are museums. About 14 or 15 years ago, a number of museums decided to Christianize themselves as universal museums. At that time, I was running a major museum that has got the largest collection in the whole world of hominid specimens. That is the National Museums of Kenya. It has the largest. It had over 1,500 staff. It had 17 museums at that time. But because we are from the south and we were the suppliers, we did not qualify to be part of the Universal Museums. So we read Mischief. And what we read was that these museums were trying to create a category that would be exempted from any interrogation of the sources of their heritage. And some of us at that time said no. So that was first attempt that more or less failed. It has been, they've started to revive it again, but it doesn't work out. So I have seen that. I have also seen the open discussion whereby taboo discussion on return, which more or less made the 1970 convention become irrelevant, has become popular. We have seen a president of one of the most important and one of the most powerful countries, France, come out in the open and say, we need to reflect on this. What have we seen? What have we learned in this? where is the problem? Later, when you give me time, I will give you a few examples of my own experience that I've experienced that touches on the feelings, the moods, the spirit of these items that we call property. But for now, I just want to comment that through my own experience, I think that we have a difficult situation. It is not easy. It's a difficult situation that needs us to reflect amongst ourselves as professionals in the business of museums, as people in international organizations like UNESCO and state parties, as communities of origins, as professional museums staff like curators, exhibition designers, directors, to try to reflect on ourselves and find out if we have changed our position in the last 20 years. For me, the problem is not a question of return. And in the past, my issue was that the museums that own this material just needed to recognize the ownership from wherever they came from. And then they could ask for permanent loans forever. Today, after listening, I think that we should be thinking of actually returning this material first and then requesting for them. But the problem is one, according to me. It is the tradition, it is the culture of the treatment of material. If we do not change the mindset of the curators and directors of museums, retrain them, deconstruct the whole concept of this particular heritage and how they look at it, I don't think that we are on the right way. We will still have problems. We have to accept within ourselves that a problem was created that needs to be dealt with. We today are talking 50 years later about decolonization of the mind, the subjects that we're doing. We need to decolonize the minds of the practitioners of the museums within, especially in the northern part, so that the attachment to this particular material, to the extent that they are willing to do anything to make sure that they completely destroy the spirit of this interrelationship that is being created, is dismantled. So I think we need to work within ourselves, in the institutions that we work in, wherever they are, but particularly in the West, so that we can be able to accept the new trend. Otherwise, there is going to be a lot of opposition, and at the end of the day, what I see is that some were saying this morning that they will give. But I think that they will probably, because if you look at most of the storage facilities in Europe, they have more than they can manage. They will look for the most, you know, whatever is doesn't mean too much, or whatever you have 20 or 30 of them and give back those ones. And I think that would be the wrong thing. So in short, what I am saying that my 20 years or more tells me that there is still a serious resistance in our capacity to accept the change that we've been talking about all this time. And until we decolonize our minds and decolonize our museums and decolonize the concept of collection, we are going to have a problem. And we need to look at that. And I'll tell you a story later about my own experience with other things. Thank you.
Je vous remercie. Effectivement, cela pose la question de la possession et de la dépossession de la mémoire et les trois mots fondamentaux qui étaient posés comme des piliers d'identité, de mémoire et de souveraineté posés par Madame Audrey Azoulay. On les retrouve en filigrane dans cet exposé d'un contexte toujours complexe. Monsieur Wendland, on prolonge cette réflexion sur ce contexte avec les projets initiés par l'OMPI dans le domaine des expressions culturelles traditionnelles, notamment chez les peuples autochtones. Comment ces projets contribuent-ils à sensibiliser les communautés à la valeur de leur patrimoine et à la nécessité de leur sauvegarde? Cela induit évidemment des réflexions sur la propriété collective de ces biens culturels.
Good afternoon. These are the world-renowned Basutu tribal blankets. They are a distinctive form of woolen blanket worn by Sotho people and unique to the kingdom of Lesotho in southern Africa. These blankets have a deep cultural significance and history. And what makes them unique is the layout of the designs, the various symbols used, the bold color combinations, and the pinstripe that you can see on the blankets. They're not secret, and I don't think that they're sacred. I'm not sure myself, but they're certainly not secret, because you can buy these blankets locally in Lesotho in South Africa for about $80. They are sold on Amazon. And then I'm the third person today to mention the Black Panther film. The Director General did, Madame Savoy did, and I'm going to do the same thing because the Basutu blankets, they inspired the blankets worn by the fictional Wakanda tribe in the Black Panther film. Then a global fashion house created shirts for men based on the designs found on the blankets. And these high-end shirts sold for 33,000 rand each. That's about $2,500 in glitzy Johannesburg and Cape Town stores, and they sold out within hours or days. Appreciation or appropriation? Cultural theft or cultural interaction? What do you think? I mention this example because it raises these questions, which of course concern intangible heritage. And I think I might be the only speaker today to talk about intangible properties and not tangible. But one of my messages is that even with tangible properties, the intangible dimension is important, because the intangible dimension is about the object's meaning, the story it tells, and its artistic form, the art and the design in it. I'm a lawyer, I'm not an ethicist, and you know that law and ethics are very far apart most of the time. So I'm an intellectual property lawyer, so the question that we ask in the IP world is this a legitimate inspiration? The example I'm giving here, or unlawful copying. And the distinction between the two is very fine, and it's very difficult to work out who owns what and who can do what with what. To go back to this example of the Basutu, they were not consulted, and they were not involved, as far as I'm aware, and they've not shared in any of the benefits that the company or the brand concerned made from selling their $2,500 shirts. This shouldn't happen. What we are trying to build are models for respectful partnerships and equitable benefit sharing. And the second message that I'd like to leave you with is that in order for those to happen, property rights are very useful. Because the Basutu probably don't have the leverage. If the company had come to them, or now, ex post facto, they don't have the leverage because they don't have a property right. And so intellectual property rights are not always suitable, quite clear about that, but they can be tactically used. And so the more one knows about IP, the more one can decide, or the Basutu could have decided, or other groups around the world could decide if, when, and how to use copyright, trademarks, even patents, and so on. IP rights have a role to play, or property rights have a role to play in empowering groups like the Basutu or the Sotho and others in cases like this. And so there's quite a lot of work being done, and this, I think, Madame Moderatrice, you'll ask me about next few minutes, but quite a lot of work is being done on two different planes. The first is, how can groups make more smart use of existing property rights? And to do that, one has to know about the IP system. What does it do? What does it not do? What are the disadvantages? What are the benefits from using the IP system? And there's one example I can give you, if you like, about where we worked with a particular group in empowering them to become copyright holders and not simply the objects of study. And that's the one I can talk about, if you like. We also work with institutions, so museums, which have been talked about a lot today. Of course, they also are in a position where they are managing collections of materials that either they own from an IP point of view or somebody else owns, and how institutions manage intellectual property rights is another important area which has a real effect in the real world. And the second plane of work is, because the existing IP system is not adequate really in this area, we all accept that, we know that, it's full of gaps, we say it's a gappy system, is work has been done on developing new sui generis, so special norms, standards, and a lot of work is being done and is being done on the development of an international legal instrument that would, of course, complement the UNESCO conventions of 2003 and also 2005. But I think I'll leave it at that for now, and if you have follow-up questions, I can talk a bit more. Thank you.
Je vous remercie. Vous avez cité le film Black Panthers également, dont nous avons vu un extrait ce matin qui a été coupé juste avant la séquence lorsque le héros demande à la conservatrice du musée « ça vaut combien ?» Je me souviens de cette scène, elle lui répond « mais ce n'est pas à vendre ». Et il lui répond, lui, « ah oui, c'est vrai, vous n'avez rien payé pour les avoir ». Je pensais à la suite de cet extrait. Madame Camardine, je rappelle, vous êtes professeure d'université à Colombo. Vous êtes également avocate au Sri Lanka. Vous êtes une des rares représentantes de la région Asie aujourd'hui et je vous remercie d'être là. Dans le contexte du Sri Lanka qui fait l'objet de vos recherches, comment, selon vous, se développe le lien entre propriété culturelle et le sentiment de perte identitaire lié à la disparition de patrimoine, que ce soit dans un contexte colonial ou dans le contexte évidemment plus récent des conflits ethniques.
Thank you very much. I'd like to start off with a very small story. When I was a child, my father took me to the museum in Colombo, and apart from a throne of the King of Kandy, there was nothing else to see, and I complained to him that the museum was very boring. And he said, if you want to see the best of Sri Lankan culture, you have to go to the British Museum. About 30 odd years later, as a lawyer, I had researched into the legal framework surrounding cultural property and figured out that there is, in relation to objects taken out during colonial times, there's no legal regime to support the return of cultural property. Before the people in the room who have advanced this argument bop me on the head for being an unemotional lawyer, I must say that this is not a position that makes me happy, but I'm glad to note that UNESCO has, since 1970s, raised this debate, kept it alive, because it has been something that in the Sri Lankan context has been disappearing from the public discourse. The last letter to England was written in 2013 by the Ministry of Cultural Affairs. It didn't elicit a response, and since then there has been no work done in that particular area. And the picture that I have chosen today is of Tara, symbolizing a lot of the research that I did. So this is not just, it's just one statue, but it symbolizes lots of the cultural property that was taken out during colonial times. This is a perfect statue. There are no parts of it missing. It's the female incarnation of the Buddha, revered very much in Sri Lanka. And there are specific, if you come to Sri Lanka, there are specific rules even for how a statue should be photographed and how a person should be photographed in relation to the statue. So a lot of it has to be appreciated in the context from which it comes, which we cannot see when a statue is displaced and placed in some other place or in another setting. So in relation, coming back to your question, in relation to objects that have been taken out during colonial times, though in terms of visual beauty or significance, they are the more valuable, the debate or the discourse has now become almost non-existent. However, Sri Lanka was also faced with a burning ethnic conflict which lasted more than 30 years and which, having ended in 2009, has now forced the country to concentrate on the more immediate problem, which is the looting and the destruction of cultural property in recent times. In this area, we have been fortunate. We have a Cultural Property Act of 1988 and a more older Antiquities Ordinance, which was recently updated, which has allowed or permitted the government and its museums to set up partnerships with other institutions to work towards preventing the export of these properties, tackling the issue of looting, and trying to keep these cultural objects or properties or this part of the heritage intact. So the debate, I believe, has been forced in that direction, that we are now trying to preserve what we have rather than asking countries that had colonized us, Britain in particular, and also the Netherlands, where there is a large collection of Sri Lankan cultural heritage, to return these objects. Thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. Desmarais, en français, je crois qu'une erreur s'est glissée dans votre biographie, dans le petit fascicule, et je vous prie d'accepter les excuses, me semble-t-il. Tout va bien. Vous êtes donc directrice des programmes et des partenariats au Conseil international des musées. Au moment où l'ICOM réfléchit à une nouvelle définition des musées, comment l'évolution des discussions sur la circulation des biens culturels s'intègre-t-elle à cette réflexion que vous voudrez bien rappeler ?
Merci. Oui. J'ai tenu à ce qu'on puisse... Oui, bon, bonjour. Mon nom est France Desmarais. Je vais parler du point de vue du Conseil international des musées, mais de manière plus générale, du point de vue professionnel. Ce matin, on a beaucoup entendu de discours politiques, ce qui est important, parce qu'on ne fait rien sans volonté politique. Donc, maintenant qu'il y a une vraie volonté politique depuis l'automne de discuter de ça, qu'est-ce qu'on fait en tant que professionnel ? Parce que la réalité, c'est que c'est un problème qui va devoir se régler de musée à musée, parce que ces objets sont des musées et ils vont peut-être, dans les cas où il y aurait des retours, retourner dans des musées. On parle de circulation. Le thème de la journée, c'est la circulation, un certain partage. Il ne faut pas oublier que si la responsabilité est partagée, si ce patrimoine représente une histoire partagée, la propriété, ma collègue l'a dit, n'est pas partagée. La propriété, elle est nationale, selon le droit. Donc, comment on peut faire circuler ces objets, etc. J'aimerais qu'on regarde deux minutes la définition du musée actuel, qui est une définition qui est reconnue dans la recommandation de l'UNESCO sur les musées, qui a été acceptée en 2015 par tous les États membres de manière unanime. Elle est inscrite dans le droit national de plusieurs pays. Et cette définition dit que le musée est une institution permanente qui acquiert. A museum acquires. And for as long as we will have that aspect in the definition of museum, we need to think of how do we acquire, what do we acquire, and what do we do from now, starting today. Because it's in the DNA of the museum and of the museum professional to constitute collections. So far, the ICOM definition of what a museum is considers that among many other things that museums do, acquisitions, collecting is really part of its mandate and its data, of its DNA. And most museum professionals will think that as a curator, if you don't collect, your institution will die. And it's really important that we try to put ourselves in that mindset Knowing that, now we have laws that are respected by museum professionals. Most importantly, I'm very happy this morning it was quoted extensively, the role and the importance of ICOM to set standard professionally, the ICOM Code of Ethics to make sure we respect ethics of collecting, of course. But starting from now, I think we need to look at solutions. And this is what museums have been starting to do. We have a new generation of museum professionals in place. Mentalities and practice are changing. So there's reason for hope. The reason we're all gathered here today is also hopeful for the future. But I would like us to focus on professional matters. Museums are custodians of these collections for the long term. George talked about 20 years. We've talked about that this is a question that is on the long term. Well, this is the beauty of museum. We're here for the next 100 years and hopefully much more. This is our job to make sure that these collections will be enjoyed for generations and generations. Once we know that, what is in the best interest of the objects? Where should it be kept and in what condition? En terminant juste sur cette réintroduction, moi je travaillais dans un musée au Canada et il faut qu'on soit conscient, quand on n'est pas un professionnel de musée, c'est peut-être difficile à comprendre, si un musée au Canada ne respectait pas nos normes très élevées de sécurité, de conservation, de climat contrôlé, etc., nous ne prêtions pas nos objets pour une exposition. Il n'y a même pas question de restitution, etc. Et ça, ce n'est pas une question néocoloniale, ce n'est pas une question controversée, c'est une question de standards et de normes de musée. Donc, je voudrais m'assurer que quand on discute de cette question, on ait aussi en tête cet aspect qui fait partie du rôle et de la responsabilité du professionnel de musée. Et après, on pourra parler évidemment d'autres aspects, mais je voulais un peu, I wanted to frame the debate on the professional aspect. And lastly, in French, there are two words for éthique and déontologie. In English, there's only one, it's ethics. Déontologie is very specific. It's, you know, a corporate code that as a profession we need to abide by that code. And ethical values is more on the moral side. So it's really interesting to distinguish the two in the work we do, and both are of course very important.
Je vous remercie. On parle même de morale en français, en plus de la déontologie. Monsieur Jean-Gabriel Le Turc, vous avez écrit en 2008, déjà, il y a déjà 9 ans, un article sur la question des restitutions et en écrivant que c'est un cas particulier des politiques patrimoniales et que son étude permet de mettre en lumière les paradoxes liés à la propriété. Pourriez-vous nous décrire les enjeux liés à cette question ?
Vous faites référence à un article qui a déjà 10 ans, on est dans un temps moyen. Qui traitait du cas particulier de l'Afrique du Nord. On disait l'Afrique, on a beaucoup parlé d'Afrique aujourd'hui, demande des restitutions, presque toute l'Afrique, sauf l'Afrique du Nord.
C'était le Maroc, la Tunisie,
le Maroc,
l'Algérie.
La Tunisie et l'Algérie, qui pourtant sont des pays qui ont connu des conflits coloniaux importants, qui ont connu la cicatrice coloniale, qui l'ont vécu. Donc l'article, en étudiant ce cas un petit peu particulier, voulait déplacer le problème, essayer de déplacer pour donner du sens un petit peu. Si on met tous les concepts dans une espèce de boîte, on arrive à un espèce de principe et le débat n'est plus possible parce qu'on ne peut être que d'accord ou on ne peut être que contre. Mais le débat est peu intelligible. Donc il s'agissait de donner du sens aux différents thèmes et aux différents concepts en les replaçant aussi dans une perspective historique. Et la perspective, c'était de comprendre le rapport de l'objet manquant, de la partie manquante, de l'objet en exil, à l'ensemble du patrimoine in situ, celui qui est resté dans le pays, à l'ensemble de la construction patrimoniale. Et en essayant de sortir aussi de la question qui crispe, de la question qui est difficile, qui est celle de la propriété. La propriété ne permet pas de décrire entièrement, de comprendre entièrement le patrimoine, le pourquoi du patrimoine. Donc si on différencie les cas, et je ne vais pas le faire ici, mais de rapatriement, les cas de retour, les cas de restitution, on voit que dans cette question de propriété, on a deux axes qui se rencontrent et qui sont problématiques, qui sont un axe qui est autour de, qui évolue autour de la symbolique. On a beaucoup parlé de la symbolique des restitutions, avec une geste qui s'accomplit, c'est-à-dire que la restitution d'un objet est censée s'adresser à l'ensemble du patrimoine et aussi à l'ensemble du passé historique du pays. Par la restitution d'un objet, ce serait comme si on réparait le passé, et en réparant le passé, c'est aussi comme si on voulait rétablir un futur possible, qui soit un futur meilleur. Ça, c'est une geste symbolique qui parfois tourne à l'expressionnisme. Je pense par exemple, pour prendre le cas algérien, en 2003, avait été proposé à la restitution le sceau du dé d'Alger, qui avait été pris lors de l'expédition de 1830. Et ce sceau était censé, c'était dans les discours, sceller l'amitié. Donc on est vraiment dans une forme d'expressionnisme pour symboliser une réconciliation. Ensuite, on a le problème beaucoup plus vaste qui est légal, avec le droit positif, les limites du droit positif, mais aussi les forces qui permettent d'appréhender le problème. J'avais étudié un cas, et je voudrais en parler parce que c'est un cas qui montre différents aspects du problème et de la question, qui est la restitution, ou le retour et le dépôt au musée d'Alger de 300 œuvres du musée des Beaux-Arts d'Alger. En 1962, ce musée, qui avait été fondé dans les années 30 comme un musée de province en France, un musée, un petit musée universel avec des objets représentatifs de toutes les époques du monde et de la civilisation de son époque, était à Alger, et les objets avaient été déplacés pour les mettre en sécurité par crainte des attentats de l'organisation terroriste nationaliste française, OAS. Les objets avaient été placés en France. En 1962, après l'indépendance, le nouvel gouvernement algérien avait demandé le retour naturel de ces objets dans le cadre de la cession d'État et de la création donc de la cession d'un ancien État colonial au nouvel État. Là, la question avait été très très longue. Si tout le monde était d'accord sur le principe, il avait fallu six ans, pour négocier ces accords qui avaient été très compliqués. Il y avait toute une partie des collections qui appartenaient, qui avaient été acquises par le musée, mais il y avait aussi les dépôts. Et la négociation était très longue, s'est heurtée à beaucoup de questions. La mise en place de l'accord est aussi complexe, avec 9 listes complémentaires, dont on s'est promis de les renégocier un jour. Et les œuvres ont fini par revenir à Alger en 1969, avec un détail intéressant qui est que les œuvres qui sont revenues à Alger en 1969 ne sont pas les mêmes que les œuvres qui avaient quitté Alger en 1962. Parce que entre les années 30 et les années 60, le goût avait changé. Et ce qu'on voulait montrer du patrimoine, ce qu'on voulait expliquer, et la construction, l'idée de la construction patrimoniale elle-même, avait évolué. Donc, on a rapporté à Alger en 1969 un musée au goût des années 60 ou des années Malraux. Avec une deuxième parenthèse qui est que quand le musée réouvre avec ses œuvres rapatriées en 1969, la construction patrimoniale et le discours culturel de l'Algérie avaient évolué, et finalement l'intérêt pour ce musée qui avait été complètement retombé. L'intérêt des collections était moindre par rapport à une demande qui revenait au contraire à des œuvres orientalistes. Cela montre des perspectives de la propriété. Donc, propriété certes d'un point de vue juridique, mais aussi les limites de la propriété culturelle. Quand on dit un peuple est propriétaire ou est dépositaire d'une réception, d'une culture ou des objets d'une culture, on voit aussi que c'est une construction. Et c'est cette construction qui doit être questionnée. Et quand on parle, c'est quel édifice patrimonial, quelle est la projection patrimoniale dans lequel on veut que des objets reviennent, ou on veut que des objets soient intégrés. Je vous remercie.
Merci. La projection, Georges Abongou, vous ne cessez de vous projeter depuis plus de 20 ans. Je crois que vous étiez déjà intervenu en disant effectivement qu'il y avait quelque chose de choquant dans le recours à la loi pour légitimer un comportement qui ne l'était pas. les mentalités évoluent lentement, quels seraient selon vous les projets qui illustrent le plus clairement l'évolution des mentalités professionnelles, politiques sur la circulation des biens, et comment ces projets ont participé à la prise de conscience sur la nécessité d'appropriation et de préservation, de conservation du patrimoine?
Thank you very much. There is a. Let me start by saying that last year in October, I think, we attended a meeting on repatriation of heritage, or proposed, or it was around that discussion. It's become very fashionable to discuss it. And we attended a meeting in one of the European cities, which I will not name. And later we were supposed to interact with an object. This object was from Africa, I think it was from Congo. And the different people who interacted with this object took it, touched it, turned it around, reacted very differently. For me, it was a very powerful force. And I'm an archaeologist. I've been a museum curator and director, so I'm very much in that line of thinking of object as object. But this object, when I looked at it, it was like, you know, don't look at me. I wasn't made to be looked at like this. I feel ashamed. I want to go home. Or at least maybe somewhere, not in the open. But to others, someone touched and said, oh, this is so beautiful, oh, fantastic. Look at the back and the way it's been carved. And so the objects mean different things to us. And sometimes it's through personal experience. And I think we need to accept this. Another case which I want to say, but before I say it, I want to say a saying in Africa that has become very common. Don't do it for me without me. I want to repeat. Do not do it for me without me. If you do it for me without me, you are against me. You take my object, you appropriate it, you put it in the museum, you say you are using your professional capacity, you exhibit it, and you deny me the right to even say I was once its owner. You are doing it for the world, you are doing it for me included. Without me, that means you are against me. I think we need to think about that. In 1972, a young American guy came to Kenya to a place called Malindi, and he was a scuba diver. So he was given the opportunity to train people in scuba diving. He took a bus across the countryside. He saw some standing carved items called vigangu. You can see an old man there, whatever is at the back. He went back to the US, to Los Angeles, a place where I have lived for a long time also. And he set up a gallery. And I can tell you that every home that matters in the United States started collecting vigango. These vigangos are representation of the people who are passed away, who want reincarnation so that their spirit can live in this. They are part and parcel of these elders that you see walking there. They are implanted in the forest. They are the ancestors. They took them and put them and turned them into museum exhibition, as you can see. Clean them up, turn them into an exhibition for display. Later, an American researcher went to Kenya in the 1980s, went, interviewed an old man, saw two vigangos. 2 weeks later, when she went back to verify what she had done, she found the vigangos had gone. They had been stolen. Fortunately, when she went back to her university museum, there was one of those vigangos, fresh, even with the clothes. In the records, the curator had said, this appears to have been used recently because even the clothes and the paintings were still fresh. The curator knew what they was doing. He knew he was Then for 10 years, there was negotiation. I was involved in that. These two vigangos were brought back. You can see them there being planted back, now under grill so that they are not stolen. That lady that looks there said something. She said, we knew that they had gone for a long walk, a long journey, but we knew they'd be back. When they were away, we suffered. There was no rain, there was adversity, there was so much hunger, but now that they are back, the spirits are with us, and we know that things will be okay. That is the feeling of what we call some of these items. Museum is fantastic. I have been the vice president of ICOM for many years, 6 years, full term. I have been director of National Museums of Kenya, one of the biggest. I know the role of the museums. But when it comes to things that matter and touch on people, sacred, things that touch on people, don't do it for them without them. Do it with them. That is what I would like to say.
Merci. When Wendland, des projets pilotes ont été menés au Kenya, à la Jamaïque. Quels enseignements peuvent être tirés d'un point de vue de la construction du rapport au patrimoine des populations autochtones?
It was beneath the old acacia tree in Laikipia, Kenya, where the elders meet, that Ola Kaunga and Ola Tingoe turned to me, this is now some years ago, and said, let's build a library of our music and sell it online like iTunes. So he was joking about the iTunes part, but they were very serious about the building a library idea. And so began an ambitious partnership, and it was a partnership, and George has just put it much better than I can. This is not something that we did for the Maasai. It was a partnership with them where they were leading us as to what they wanted and what their needs were. The background to the project, or in summary, it was essentially we helped the Maasai to become their own archivists, to record their own intangible heritage. So they were on the other side of the camera. They were the ones doing the filming and the recording because that gave them the copyright. So let me just go back a few steps. The way copyright functions is that the owner of the copyright in a photograph, in field notes, in a film, in a sound recording, is the person who made the notes, who took the photograph, who made the film. And that's normally, it's a folklorist, an ethnomusicologist, it's a museum official of some kind, and therefore the copyright, the rights to control, or the rights to have a choice over how to use the recording and the photograph, doesn't vest in the people who were filmed and who were telling their stories, but in the ethnomusicologist or the folklorist who made the film and made the notes and the photographs. So the people themselves have no control over how the recordings are used, and there are many cases that you all know quite well, I'm sure, of very well-meant but ethnographic recordings housed in museums, folk life centers around the world that fell into the hands of companies that then made music, for example, from them. And the songs Return to Innocence and the Deep Forest album are enigmatic, are iconic examples of what I'm speaking about. So the project really aimed at converting the Maasai from being the objects of study to being the producers of their own heritage and the producers of their own archives, and therefore the owners of the copyright. Now, we didn't do this alone. We did it again as a big partnership. The National Museums of Kenya, George's institution, one of his staff came on all the trainings and was with us. the Messiah, of course. We also worked very closely with the American Folklife Center at the Library of Congress and the Center for Documentary Studies at Duke. Here you have a photograph. There's Anne. So we trained two of the Maasai, Olotengoy and Anne Tome, and you see her here towards the end of the training, where we had bought equipment. She had had the training in the US, and then we bought the equipment for them, and now she's back in Laikipia, in Ngwezi is the name of the actual place, and it's about 6 hours drive from the nearest town. And this is where we went a few times and spent time there training, consulting, very importantly. And here you see the results of that, where she is interviewing one of the members of the group. Today, the Maasai, this particular group, has about 150 video recordings and 200 photographs. And there are opportunities. This project lies really at the center or at the crossroads of cultural heritage preservation, the promotion of cultural diversity, entrepreneurship, and management of copyright, at that crossroads. I will end by saying that, of course, there are many lessons learned from a project like this, as you can imagine. It's, as I said in the beginning, it was very ambitious. Consultation, obviously a key part, again, going back to what we said earlier, it was with the Maasai, not something for them. Sustainability of these projects is always a challenge. Managing expectations beyond a certain point is also, again, a challenge. And of course, one has to situate a project like this within the very real circumstances that the Maasai find themselves in, dealing with rural poverty, environmental degradation, climate change, displacement, and land loss. And so these are the larger challenges in which this kind of work is taking place. Just to end, the National Museums of Kenya was an integral part of this project, and the project is also about not only the Maasai in this particular case, how do they become owners of copyright and then how do they manage those rights, but also the institutions where the recordings are then held, what are their intellectual property related challenges and how should they manage copyright in a way that is beneficial to all concerned in this area. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Je pensais à la Cité de la musique et la Philharmonie de Paris qui conserve, préserve et promeut des sons dans le respect des copyrights. Revenons au Sri Lanka. Pardonnez-moi parce que je vais vous presser un petit peu parce que l'heure tourne un peu trop vite. Et j'ai un petit rappel de cette heure. Si on revient à la situation du Sri Lanka, comment s'articule dans le débat public la réflexion sur les droits moraux ?
Yes. Now, this takes a very nationalist perspective. Anybody in Sri Lanka would say, yes, anything that came from my country is mine and it should be returned to me. I believe there are two focal points to this debate. The first is the concept of ownership. The Eastern and Western models differ very greatly. And I'm looking at it from Sri Lanka's perspective because we were colonized by three Western countries, and two of them hold a lot of our property. When Arahat Mahinda met King Devanampiyatissa decades, centuries ago, the king was about to shoot a deer on the basis that he was the king and this belonged to him. And Arahat Mahinda, who brought Buddhism to the country, prevented him from doing so, reminding him that as king, he was only the guardian of the property, not the owner. But the Western model of ownership is very different, where the conqueror has the right to claim all the spoils of war. So we need to clear up which concept, which framework, which lens we're looking at this from. And very quickly moving on to the second point, the legitimacy of the use of force. As far as I know, the use of force was declared to be outlawed by the UN in 1945, following the end of the Second World War. we have to think whether we are going to carry that backwards and to say that any activity done using force, even before the formal outlawing of the use of force, whether it's going to have an impact, because that would really enliven this moral rights debate. Whether when this property was taken, was use of force legitimate? Yes. Then have we delegitimized it? And have we, in retrospect, taken it back to the time when these acts were done? Otherwise, the moral rights debate will be confined to people like me saying, I want it, and other people saying, you can't have it.
France, Desmarais, pouvez-vous nous, je sais que vous êtes concise, je vous en remercie, nous citer quelques exemples où la médiation de l'ICOM a été sollicitée pour nourrir la réflexion ou pour faciliter les échanges et les négociations dans des cas de litige sur la circulation du patrimoine.
Yeah, I think it's time to be forward-looking and to be pragmatic and constructive. What can we do starting from now, knowing that we have this aim to try to solve this issue? What do we do? One of the good examples of the fact that there's no one-size-fits-all solution, there will never be. So drafting up something that would apply across the board will not work and will not apply across the board. We need to look at this on a case-by-case situation. And a good example of that is the case of the Makonde mask. The case of the Makonde mask, and it will go back to ownership, or what's at stake here, was owned by a Swiss museum, so privately owned, and requested by a country. So in this case, we cannot speak under the aegis of something that's intergovernmental, because we don't have two states owning and talking. And ICOM offered its good offices to two parties who were willing to enter into discussion. So again, we will need to make sure that there's goodwill to discuss, to sit around the table, to at least start talking. And trust needs to be rebuilt. We need to understand, and the Global North needs to understand, that there are trust issues in the Global South with good reason, and we need to work very hard to rebuild that trust. So I think ICOM is viewed as offering neutral, trusting, and also confidential framework where people willing to enter into debate can discuss. So the case of the Makonde mask was solved and was returned to Tanzania, but this is a good example because it had been c'était un litige depuis 18 ans. Et donc, il a fallu deux personnes qui, à un moment donné, étaient prêtes à discuter et arriver à une discussion. Mais on avait besoin aussi d'une plateforme, neutre, confidentielle et professionnelle qui permettait d'arriver à une solution. Donc ça, c'est un des exemples. Mais on voit très bien, et ça a été cité souvent ce matin, le besoin de guidance. On a besoin de l'ICOM ou d'autres types d'infrastructures professionnelles, parce que le monde a besoin des musées. Ce n'est dans l'intérêt de personne de vider des musées ou d'affaiblir des institutions. On a besoin de partager. Le titre de la journée, c'est ça. Donc, à partir de ce fait, comment on partage, de quelle façon on rétablit la discussion, on rétablit une certaine transparence aussi dans les discussions. Je pense que c'est important. Transparency is really key in building trust. And we talk on equal basis, on a professional basis, and we try to be constructive and forward-looking. Creative solutions are found every day in museum. At the national level, sometimes objects are temporarily lent for ceremonial purposes, go back to the museum. The community has no interest of having to care, secure, etc., these objects. Sometime, if we sat around the table and discussed, we would find out that it's not as scary as we think it is. Museum must not be so afraid, because in the end, the solution may not be as threatening as they think it is. Nobody wants to empty the museums of the world, because the world needs museums.
Je vous remercie. Justement, au regard de l'évolution des politiques patrimoniales, Jean-Gabriel Le Turc, c'est à vous que je m'adresse. Comment la question des restitutions a-t-elle été reformulée?
Bénédicte Savoie, ce matin, faisait référence à la citation de Mata Rembo en 1978 et en demandant qu'est-ce qui s'est passé depuis 40 ans. Il s'est passé beaucoup de choses depuis 40 ans. On a changé plusieurs fois de paradigme presque avec le lien très très fort entre patrimoine et développement. Développement économique, c'est quelque chose qui revient toujours. Et deux conventions, l'UNESCO a fait des conventions, la déclaration de 2001 sur les diversités, la diversité culturelle, et la convention de 2005 sur le patrimoine immatériel. Donc on a pu incorporer de nouveaux objets au patrimoine. Je pense à la place Jamal Fna au Maroc, qui à l'indépendance était détestée par les indépendants parce que c'était du folklore, des archaïsmes ou de l'orientalisme, et qui aujourd'hui fait partie du patrimoine. Aujourd'hui, qu'est-ce qui est nouveau? Peut-être on est au début d'une nouvelle période où on parle justement de circulation des objets, de coopération, qui sont les réponses qui sont apportées aujourd'hui à la question des restitutions.
Pardon, on me presse de conclure, mais je voudrais que ce soit vous qui concluiez. Je préférerais Monsieur Abongou, qui avait ce combat chevillé au corps, au-delà des situations de crise et des confrontations politiques, quelles sont les perspectives que vous souhaitez?
I think a lot of things that I would like to see have also been said by my colleagues here. I think there's need for trust. And trust also means that you believe in others. If the museum professionals believe that the communities cannot take care of their heritage, there is no way that you are going to have a discussion. If the communities continue to believe that the mindset in the museum will never be changed, there will be no discussion. I think that we need to learn from good examples. I think that we need to agree together that it is in the benefit of all of us to be able to work together and to create a situation where we can be able to listen to one another. And we should also be able to be ready to change our mindsets, because some of us are trained to behave and to think in that particular way. And unless we are willing to be able to change, we cannot be able to discuss. I see that there is an opportunity. I see that this attempt that has been made here, it has been now internationalized. I think that anybody who is going to drag us behind would find that there are going to be people standing at the back and pulling us back. And so I can see a force in which if we can all be together without saying this group is bad, this group is good, and all and that, and through mediation, through understanding one another, through appreciating one another, I think we can be able to do that. And there's no better organization than UNESCO, which was founded on the premise that if you are able to understand one's culture, if you are able to understand one's through education, through science, through culture, then you will be able to appreciate. That war begins in the minds of men, and it's in the minds of men that peace must be constructed. So temporarily we are having a war, but I think we need to create peace, and peace must first be created through the mindset. We must change our mindset, we must be able to accommodate one another. I think that is the way forward. Thank you.
Je vous remercie. Je vous laisse peu de temps. Je vous laisse peu de temps, mais au titre de l'OMPI, quand même, sur les perspectives, quels autres ou un autre un type d'accompagnement que ces projets développés ont inspiré?
I'll just, because time is very short, just try to sum up perhaps in two or three lines. Cultural interaction means, I think, and cultural diversity, the 2005 convention, means that cultures should be able to be used by others. There should be cultural interaction, but that has to be done in a respectful way, and the Basutu case I mentioned is an example of how things should not happen. But for respectful partnerships and equitable benefit sharing to happen, property rights are important because they give groups leverage and they empower them to negotiate proper partnerships, and that's why it's important.
Thank you. Thank you. Comment le Sri Lanka entend-il retrouver et préserver son patrimoine culturel? En une phrase, un défi.
Japan and the US have been helping us both after the tsunami and the ethnic conflict, and now we have maritime museums and other museums in smaller parts, cities where these events have taken place, and that's better than bringing them to Colombo, because the Colombo Museum was also robbed a few years back and we haven't found many of those artifacts. It was already bare and now it's barer. And I think if there was an international debate on the restitution of colonial property, that would be very useful to Sri Lanka, so that it could also partner with other countries and organizations that have the expertise to take that debate forward, because I think that's something very important. I can see that it has died down, but I would very much like to see that debate being revived again. Thank you.
Well, thank you. LICOM. Comment l'ICOM envisage que le débat actuel puisse influencer la dynamique à l'œuvre parmi ses membres et rééquilibrer ses champs d'intervention, également en une phrase si possible.
Oui. La pertinence de l'ICOM montre toute sa force dans ce genre de sujet, donc ça ne va pas changer l'ICOM, ça va renforcer l'ICOM dans son aspect de dialogue. La présidente de l'ICOM nous a demandé d'appuyer les musées, de travailler à leur côté à ce sujet. Donc nous serons aux côtés des musées qui sont des deux côtés de this issue. On travaille avec des musées de partout dans le monde et on veut les rassurer sur le fait qu'ils peuvent compter sur notre soutien et notre accompagnement s'ils le souhaitent, et que l'ICOM va continuer à faire ce qu'elle fait depuis toujours, développer des standards, développer des normes, et l'important c'est que ça s'applique à tout le monde. Aux États-Unis par exemple, on a changé la déontologie des collections le jour où les grands musées qui collectionnent se sont mis d'accord, parce que si un seul musée le fait et que les autres ne suivent pas, ce ne sera pas possible, parce qu'on a besoin de demeurer concurrentiel. Donc l'idée de l'ICOM, c'est de s'assurer, comme la code de déontologie, que les standards soient appliqués across the board et s'applique à tout le monde et qui soit universel. Et c'est vers ça qu'on va travailler pour ces questions qui sont très spécifiques.
Merci. Le mot de la fin. Comment et pourquoi, très rapidement, la réflexion sur ces questions patrimoniales peut contribuer au renouvellement des politiques culturelles?
Vous parlez de la construction patrimoniale, et c'est exactement ça, continuer de construire et de construire différemment, construire ensemble. C'était la phrase très importante de Georges, construire ensemble, connaître les collections, les inventorier, différencier l'histoire et la mémoire, affronter nos mémoires parfois conflictuelles, exposer les œuvres, faire circuler les expositions, former, montrer, expliquer. Et ce sera ça le partage.
Je vous remercie infiniment, tous les cinq.